Hi, I'm Ben Marriott. I make weekly motion design and animation tutorials, and this week I'm going to show you how I animated this Jon Snow character portrait. Okay, we're going to be focusing mainly on this first scene here. In motion design, you're going to come across a lot of situations where the script or storyboard requires you to stay on a character for an extended period of time without them really doing much. So I'm going to show you all of my animation tricks for keeping a scene interesting when it's just a character not doing anything at all. I've drawn this in Illustrator and I've separated each element that I want to animate individually. Now that we've imported our file into After Effects, let's take a few minutes to color, label, and pre-comp some of our elements so it's easier to handle. Okay, now we're nice and organized, let's decide what elements we're going to animate. We're going to animate the snow falling in the background. We're going to animate the shine reflecting off his sunglasses. We're going to have his hair waving in the wind. We're going to have his head moving up and down subtly, having his eyebrows raised as well, his cheeks puffing up, his lips puckering, his sword moving maybe a tiny bit. And I know John would never have Longclaw on his back, but without it, he just looks like Ringo Starr. And we're also going to animate a grain shading into this as well, as seen in my previous tutorial. All right, let's animate our snowflakes. Let's get rid of the snowflakes all layer. So we've just got this one element to work with. Let's set the first position of our snow off the screen up here like this. Make a keyframe there. And let's mark its final position down somewhere below the bottom of the screen here. Now this looks a little bit too fast. Let's move this keyframe over. Let's make some additional points on this path by just moving our snowflake. To smooth those out, let's grab our Convert to Vertex tool from up here and just add some anchor points to make that nice and smooth. Let's add some rotation keyframes to that. Alright, I think that actually needs to be a little bit slower as well. So I'm just going to select all of these keyframes, hold Alt on my keyboard and drag out this last keyframe, which will keep the proportion that we've already established. All right, that's looking much better. Now we just need to duplicate that a few more times and offset them so they all fall at a nice pace. There we are, the snow is done. It gets a little sparse towards the end here, but we're probably not gonna use the very end of this comp anyway. Now the shine on the sunglasses. Let's create a new rectangle with no fill and let's bump up the stroke so it matches our reflection here. And now let's rotate this so it matches the angle that we want. And I'm going to adjust the rectangle path here so it matches the distance between our glasses that we've got here. And let's place it just to the left of our glasses here. I'm going to keyframe that first position and about 2 seconds in, let's drag this to the right. Great, now let's easy ease those keyframes with F9. Alright, that's much too slow. Let's drag this keyframe to make it faster. Alright, that's pretty good. We should also rename this layer Shine. And let's add the Set Matte effect, so it's only visible behind the glasses. And we want to select Take the Matte from Glasses Right, first of all. And you want to make sure the layer you're taking the matte from has continuously rasterize on here. I might just go ahead and turn that on for all my layers actually, so I don't run into trouble later. Let's drag that under our eyebrows layer. And we've still got the shine from our Illustrator file on this glasses layer. So let's add a fill effect to hide that. And select purple. Let's copy that effect onto our glasses left as well. And let's put the shine onto our left glass as well by duplicating it over here and then changing the matte to glasses left. There we go, got a reflection happening. Now let's do his hair waving in the wind. I'm gonna make some new shapes to get this effect right. So I'm gonna take his existing hair strands and just lower the transparency so I can use them as guides. Now I'm gonna create an elongated sort of teardrop shape. Now let's pre-comp this hair strand. Now I'm gonna drag the anchor point up to the root here to make it easier for rotating and scaling. So let's rotate this and position and scale it where one of our guide hairs is going to be. Let's actually drag it off so it's a bit more visible when we add our waving effect. And to do that, we're gonna add the wave warp effect, which you can find in here, wave warp. And let's change the direction perpendicular to the way our direction is pointing. Now let's tweak the wave width and height till we get something we're happy with. Okay, that's looking pretty close, but the root of our hair isn't staying still. It's wiggling all over the place. But we can stop that by pinning the top edge here. So now if we play back, you'll see that area stay still. Now let's drag that back and see how it looks in game context. Now let's tweak some of these settings a little more till we get what we want. Okay, I think that's pretty close. Now let's go ahead and do that for all our other hair strands. Okay, now that we've done that, I can kind of see it looks a little too underwatery and perfect, this sort of wave to me at the moment. So one thing that might alleviate that is adding a rotation keyframe to each strand of hair as well. So let's go and do that. Okay, I think that helps our first strand here look a little more chaotic. Let's do the same thing to our other hair compositions. There we go, hair done. Now let's get our head moving. The first thing to do before we animate our head is to select all the elements that relate to the head that are attached to the head, like the nose and the lips and the hair. And we just want to make sure those are parented to the head before we move it. So if you select them all and then select your pick whip on any of them and just hover over the head, they'll all be parented to the head. And you can do that even with the head selected. Now, if we move our head, all the other pieces are gonna move with it. Now let's move our anchor point in our head using our anchor point move tool here and just drag that to around where we think the neck would connect. Now let's animate the rotation. We want to be pretty subtle here, so I reckon that should be enough. And let's animate the position just very slightly too. There we are, so he's just raising his head a little bit. Now let's do the same thing to our eyebrows by animating the position and the rotation property. Now that we've got this animation happening, I think that our shine from our sunglasses should happen midway through this head movement. So let's go and adjust that. And let's do the same thing with the cheeks as well. And now for our puckering lips. We can animate those using the scale property. We hold down S, and we want to unlink our proportions here. So we unclick this, because we want to make our lips wider and then narrower. And when you do this, you should be very careful because it can look weird and stretched and warped, like you see here, if you push it too far. And we really don't want to break the design that we've established here. So let's start at maybe sort of 1/10%, keyframe that, and then go to 90%. 10% either way, you should be able to get away with. All right, I think that looks pretty good. Now let's animate Longclaw up here. I think we're just gonna animate his rotation and position. So let's move his anchor point down here to where the sword would be attached, which it wouldn't be attached. But if it was, that's where it would be attached. Let's alter the position and rotation. So as his head comes up, maybe the sword sort of comes down a touch and rotates this way as if he's sort of looking up and his body's kind of shifting. There we are. Looking at it now, I definitely think we need some animation in the body, especially with the fur section of his coat here. So let's just animate the position and rotation of those as well. All right, I've animated those two little fur sections. Now let's animate the shape of his main body here. So the straps, I'm gonna animate their position. That's good, I kinda like them coming inwards as if he's sort of taking a breath out and sort of pulling his coat around him as he does that. Now I've laid down pretty much all of the animation keyframes that we're gonna need to use. The next step is to add that animated grain texture, which is really gonna bring life and shading to the piece. But before we do that, I really want to make sure that I'm really happy with the majority of how the animation's looking, because it's gonna be just a little bit more difficult to adjust once our texture's added. So this is the point where you wanna send it to your client for review and make sure that generally the animation has been approved. That is if you can, and sometimes you can't always can. So I'm gonna go through, do one more pass of every feature, and just make sure I'm happy with the easing and the amount they're rotating and stuff like that. All right, let's get stuck in. I'm pretty happy with how it is now, but I've noticed that the snowflakes are falling slowly down vertically, but Jon Snow's hair is being, you know, brushed to the side pretty aggressively. So the wind isn't, you know, making sense for both of these objects. So we could try to pre-comp these snow layers and maybe rotate them a little bit and maybe up the speed, but I gave that a go and it didn't quite look right. So the best thing to do here is just start again. So I'm gonna delete all these snowflake layers and do the same thing we did before, but moving from left to right and having less of this sort of gentle wave. There you go. I think that's much better and was actually a lot quicker than doing it the first time. All right, on to texturing. Now we're gonna add our animated grain. And this is going to be the same method that I used in one of my previous tutorials, method 2 in that video. Without going into the details of the other video, I made a looping texture using a grain brush in Photoshop. Now to apply our grain, we're going to take our grain pre-comp, drag it into this comp. Let's say we're applying that to our head. I'm going to place this above our head layer. Let's change the color with the fill effect, and let's just eyedropper this darker flesh color here. And we're going to apply set matte like we did earlier. And we're going to make sure that this layer is continually rasterized as well and choose head. And we also want to parent it to our head as well. So now as we play through, it's parented and texturing our head. And if we don't want it to affect our ear over here, which happens to be on the same layer as the head, we can just select our pen tool and click around and create a mask. There we go. So let's do that for every single one of these layers. All right, we've added all of our grain layers and I'm pretty happy with the result. Now, it doesn't take quite as long as you'd think. I already had this style frame made up with an earlier design, so I kind of knew where I wanted the grain to be and what color I wanted it to be. I think in total there's about 36 layers of grain shading here, and it took me about 30 to 40 minutes to add all of them, I'd say. This is a lot more grain layers than I would typically do in an animation. And with 36 extra layers, it can look a little more crowded, but if you'd shy all those layers, it's not that difficult to deal with really. So if you need to edit anything, it shouldn't be too much trouble. Now let's take a quick look at that second scene of the animation. All right, now here's our second scene completed. Now I've applied the same process from our first scene. This one is much easier because there was barely any animation. We've got our snowboard just bobbing up and down with some position keyframes and slightly wobbling left to right. And for these trees in the background, I've done the same thing that we did for our snowflakes. Got a position keyframe, taking it from off screen left up diagonally to off screen right. And I've duplicated that a bunch of times that you can see here. For the trees in the front, I've made them larger and they're going a little bit faster. So there's a bit of parallax happening there. And then I've done the same with some lumps of snow in the background as well. And that's pretty much for the animation on this scene. Now let's go to a composition with all of these scenes together and take a look at the final effects that we're going to apply. All right, so this is our top composition with all our scenes inside it. I've got an end scene as well. That's just some simple text. One thing we have added here is we've added a slight push in with our scale property. The main scenes are actually 1400 pixels wide, and this top one is 1080 by 1080. So that means we can push into about 77% without getting any loss of resolution here. So I've just got a slight push in on this first scene to make it more dramatic, and then a quick pull out into this second snowboarding scene here as well. And that just adds a nice extra bit of movement to scenes that don't really have much animation going on. Now the next effect we've got is pretty subtle, so let's zoom in. And what I've done here, so I've turned this layer on, you can see the edges of this kind of bleeding in slightly. Now what I've done is I've duplicated that comp, set a Gaussian blur to 25 pixels, and set the blending mode to pin light, which just sort of means the edges of these areas will have this little glow, especially when the light area meets a dark area. It's very subtle here, but you'll see it a bit more with the other effects that we've got. The next effect we've got is on an adjustment layer, and it is a gradient ramp. If we turn that layer on, you can see it adds this kind of haze and a slight grade to our animation here. And that's using the blending mode overlay and the opacity at 50%. We rack that all the way up to the top and set this to normal. You can see what this layer looks like normally. So let's undo those. And you can actually experiment on the fly using these color pickers up here. So if you select one of the colors, it'll update on the fly. Say you want to try, you know, a bluer light coming from the top left. Or you maybe want to try something, you know, warmer. It's very easy to play around and find something you're happy with. And this gradient ramp accentuates that kind of blooming effect that we had from our other pin light layer here. This next adjustment layer has some of my classic effects that I always go to. It's got a turbulent displace and a posterize time. The turbulent displace just roughens up the edges of everything really and makes these little bumps so it just looks a little more organic, I guess. And I use posterize time to make this look like it was animated in 12 frames per second. So without the posterized time, it kind of looks a lot sort of smoother and you can see every frame every second. With the posterized time on there, it kind of looks like It has a lower frame rate, but it makes it look like it's more traditionally hand animated. And with the 12 frames per second frame rate, it kind of looks like it has a bit more of a hand animated look to it, which I kind of enjoy most of the time. Now the last two effects are these texture layers. And I use these all the time. If we go and have a look, it's just this piece of paper painted black that I rotate and loop a few times. I set that to screen and that just adds these sort of white speckly sort of grain and grit noises to the whole thing, which I love. And I've also got one down below here that is set to multiply, and that one has sort of these more darker sort of purple speckles that I've got colored here. I'm using Video Copilot's Color Vibrance plugin to isolate the lighter areas of that texture, and I've just colored them purple because I don't want them to be black or too dark or muddy that you might get just using a multiply effect. And that plugin's free. Praise be to Video Copilot. Now here's the full animation with all these effects. And this is definitely, one of the dumbest things I've ever animated. If you use any of the techniques or processes that you've learned in this video, please share them and tag me at Ben_Married_ on Instagram so I can share them in my stories. I'll be sharing a new Jon Snow pun every week that the Game of Thrones season finale is running. And trust me, this is not the worst one. Not by far. Please let me know in the comments what tutorials you'd like to see next from this channel. Don't forget to subscribe, hit that bell icon, share, and absolutely decimate that like button. I'll see you next week.